Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I'm picking up where I last left off on my migrating code from bad C++ 98 code that I wrote in 1997 to modern, clean, maintainable, happy code in C++ 17. So we did the restoring the C++ 98 version, the 98 to 11, then 11 to 14, which was fairly minor changes, but important changes in some cases because of what will be coming in the future. And now we need to move to C++ 17. This episode is sponsored by JetBrains. As C++ developers, we are honored to contribute to self-driving technology, simplify lives with many useful embedded devices, and support financial ecosystems. Truly, C++ is now at the essence of almost everything. But to keep up with the pace of development, we need tools that help us work quickly and effectively every day. CLion is a cross-platform IDE by JetBrains that makes this challenge its main goal, integrating code analysis, refactoring, debugging, and the best ecosystem tools natively into your day-to-day development workflows. Use CPP Weekly CLion to get 25% off at checkout when you purchase a new CLion subscription or renew your existing one. We need to decide at some point what we're going to do with these confusingly similar parameters. I think it makes sense to just leave it how it is. It's the numerator and it's the denominator. We're going to leave those alone. And I could move all of these operators to be public friends. I should probably do that at some point, but I don't think it's going to make a whole lot of a difference here because we don't have any implicit conversions anyhow. And that matters more for like ADL kinds of things. This entire thing is constexpr. None of that can change. But we do have the question of which attributes were added in C++ 17. And again, sorry for the very bright screen, but we do have fall through, no discard, and maybe unused added in C++ 17. This is the question that we now have to ask ourselves. Is it a bug in our code if we divide two rational numbers and discard the result of that division? And I would say that is, in fact, a bug in our code. That would be if we had done something like this. If we had just done this division and ignored the result, is that a bug in our code? And I would say almost 100% certainly that is a bug in our code. Now we're going to see that this is failing to compile because this is a C++ 17 attribute. So let's go ahead and change our standard to C++ 17. And so is it similarly a bug to discard the result of multiplication or an addition or a subtraction? Or if we explicitly ask for the denominator, is it a bug to not use it? Or if we do a unary minus to negate this, is that a bug? I think so. If we call get numerator and ignore the return, is that a bug? Yes. If we call get float and ignore the return, is that a bug? Yes. If we do a comparison operator and ignore the return value, is that a bug? Yes. If we call empty and ignore the return value, is that a bug? Yes. Now, if we call pop and ignore the return value, is that a bug? Maybe not, in fact, because pop is a non-const member function, and it is okay to just say, no, I just want to pop and discard the top item on the stack. I don't necessarily need that value back. So I'm not going to mark that one, no discard. I know some of you were wondering if we'd ever get to that point. Now, is it a bug to ignore the return value of emplace? I just created a new object. Now, the main thing I wanted to do was create the object. Is it okay if I don't immediately use that? Yes, that's okay. That is not no discard. Now, is it a bug to call peak and not use the return value? And I would say, yes, it is a bug. And what you'll start to see as a pattern is that all const member functions that return a value should probably be marked no discard. And that is going to come up here. These are not member functions. They're free functions that return values. These are probably Yes, all going to be no discard as well. Calling of has more tokens. Yeah, that should be no discard. Calling of next token. Yeah, that should be no discard as well. All right. And if we evaluate an expression, we should probably want the result of evaluating that expression. Now observe, all of my dependencies also have to recompile here because they are now also being used in C++ 17 mode. Okay, those all compiled. Radical change coming. And it's going to be driven in part by the fact that C++ 17 added string view. So if I say, I want to parse string views, I want to avoid creating new strings as much as possible, then I have object lifetime questions. So if this is using a string view, and I come into my main here, and I've got this string-like data that I'm passing into this string tokenizer, this is potentially a problem. So let's do it like this. This is now a string that is a const character literal, so this still works. But if you use string views and you have the string popped from the stack or destroyed before you're done using it, then you end up with some very serious object lifetime problems. And I think that this is now going to make us think about the actual usability of our library. The fact that I need to manually create a tokenizer and then evaluate the expression to get the answer, that seems silly. So let's go ahead and just create a thing called evaluate. It's just called evaluate, and it takes a string view for input. And it should be no discard. And we're now going to hide these implementation details from the user of our library. And we'll watch how this cleans up all of our subsequent code. As a rule of thumb, you want to pass string views by value because they're trivially easy to copy. So it's giving me this warning that the address of this value might escape the function, but I know by the design of this project that it can't. I, as the string tokenizer, am owning the string view, and I am always returning substrings inside the same string view. And now it's possible that string view were to somehow outlive the underlying data, then that's a problem for object lifetime, but I have, by design, made it that no one has access to the internals of this. I know that that string view is going to live as long as the evaluation goes because I am doing all of it right here. And I also know that I will get a crash from my address sanitizer if I'm doing anything improper with my string view here. Now I have the problem that A2I does not work with string views, and we're going to have to sort that out. Now these string functions require a standard string, and I don't have a standard string. I have a string view. So it's the equivalent to calling .cstring here. It doesn't actually help me at all. From cars was added in C++ 17, became const expert in C++ 23. So from cars expects a first and a last pointer and a reference to the object that you want me to construct. Let's use that. Okay, that should clear that up, and I should be able to get rid of this no lint now here. Let's make sure our test pass. Now, as an aside, this is a great part of C++, that as it is relatively strongly typed, I can refactor large chunks of code and then just rely on the compiler to find any bugs that I created for me. All right, all the tests pass. Now, you may have observed that I now have string view, and string view was created by the C++ standards committee to be const expert enabled. String, it's not const expert until C++ 20. So I can, besides the fact that I am doing way, way fewer allocations because I'm not making substring copies all over the place, I can make all of this code constexpr now. And you might have also noticed that because I used auto throughout the code, moving from string to string view required very few changes. Now, it is something of a downside that if the code is constexpr, then it effectively needs to live in the header file. Now, I personally think that this is one of the most powerful use cases of string view in C++ 17. If you are careful with the lifetime of the thing that you are parsing, that input string, then you can get highly composable, very efficient use of just views inside of strings without ever having to make any extra string view copies and completely avoiding heap allocations. Which means we no longer now need the string tokenizer CVP file. And hopefully all of our tests compile and run. Okay, here's a good little cleanup that my IDE is recommending for me here. And I could have been doing this since I think C++ 11, if not 14. And it says use default member initializer. So let's go ahead and do that. We're going to do that here as well. Now, what that did is it simplified our constructor a fair bit by no longer needing to initialize the current offset and the more tokens. And these things are all declared and used inside the header file. So I think this is an absolutely spectacular way of simplifying our constructor and ensuring that these things are always initialized no matter what. Okay, I believe everything is working and compiling here. We should take advantage of one more thing that was added in C++ 17. This is the greatest common divisor and also least common multiple were added. These were both added in C++ 17. They're constexpr by default. And it seems like this is a pretty good place to go ahead and add them. So this is the least common multiple of two integers and the greatest common divisor of two integers. And what we want to be able to do is easily simplify our rational numbers. Now, what I'm going to do is return a new rational number that has been simplified. And I want to automatically simplify each of these as I am creating them. All right, so I already foresaw that this would happen, that I'm not getting this. This is going to be a failure because I have the simplification in place now. If you saw that in a previous episode, so this should be 3/4. And notice we get this as a compile time failure because this is a static require. Okay, something goofy is happening here because I am getting this static assertion when I should instead be getting not a static assertion. I should be getting a runtime assertion. Catch config runtime static require is being defined. And the IDE thinks that I'm coming in this way. Catch config runtime static require. So this is actually coming in from clang tidy, not from my compiler. That is frustrating. I'm intending to use clang tidy in parallel with my compiler, but clang tidy doesn't seem to have gotten this defined. All right, I'm going to move on from here. This is a build system issue that I need to sort out at some point in the future. But regardless, we know that this should be simplified to 3/4. And let's just run all of our tests again. Okay, so we get test failures, not surprisingly, again. So 4/2, we expect to become 2, and we expect 20/2 to become 10. Okay, we should almost certainly add some explicit test and probably some fuzz testing to all of this with our string tokenizer specifically. And I do have in my test framework here a fuzz test tool that is already ready to go. So let's go ahead and see if we can go ahead and do a little bit of fuzz testing. This expects to just use the LLVM fuzzer test one input, and it gives us a chunk of data of a specific size. And we're not going to care about the rest of this boilerplate helper stuff that was here, but we do need to enable fuzz testing and build with clang to really get the advantage here. So for the moment, I'm just going to set this up. So this is actually a valid use case of reinterpret cast because you're allowed to view anything through a const character pointer. And yes, I'm going to get a do not use reinterpret cast, but that is valid place here. Now I am ignoring the return value of this thing intentionally, actually. So I have to do something like this. Okay, let's go ahead and compile this. It says C standard int is not used, but I don't believe that's actually the case. And then we can actually run this fuzz tester for a little while with our sanitizers running and see if we get anything happening in this code. All right, I have a proper fuzz tester compiled. Let's go ahead and see what happens. Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Immediately get a deadly signal. That's not great. Corpus not provided. Const reference. Mlane failed. All right. Where is this? I need the backtrace. Find token end. Now I am, let's see if string is empty, then I want to exit. So start is one. Okay. So string is not empty. Cannot create a lazy string with address. I was given a valid pointer and a size of zero. So, can I create a zero-sized string with string view? I should be able to do that. Yeah, it's a valid empty string. That's fine. Has more tokens defaulted to true, but that's not necessarily the case. If it's an empty string, then it's not going to have more tokens. Let's see what this does. Next token. All right, so we clearly have some error handling that we need to figure out. And let's go ahead and push that to the next episode, I think. We're going to stop here on our move to C++ 17. We know that we have bugs to fix.